In mathematics, the notion of continuity occurs everywhere. The study of continuity in an abstract setting is called topology. Here the most fundamental concept is that of a topological space. Before we can talk about topological spaces, we first have to understand continuity a bit better. So let's start with the epsilon delta definition of continuity. The map F is continuous at x if for every epsilon range around f of x, we can find a delta range around x that maps entirely into the epsilon range. Visually, the blue part of the graph stays inside the red area. For a smaller epsilon, we may have to choose a smaller delta. Instead of always having to find such a delta, we can also take a different approach. We can consider the pre-image of the epsilon ball around f of x, then f is continuous at x if this pre-image contains a delta ball around x. Any set that contains a small delta ball around x is called a neighborhood of x. So we can say that f is continuous at x if and only if the pre-image of every epsilon ball around f of x is a neighborhood of x. We can rewrite this in a slightly more general form. If we take any superset U of an epsilon ball, then its pre-image is also a neighborhood of x, because pre-images preserve set inclusions. Hence, f is continuous at x if and only if the pre-image of every neighborhood of f of x is a neighborhood of x. This means that to understand continuity, we only need to know what the neighborhoods at each point look like. So we could define a topological space as a set X with a function which assigns to each point a collection of neighborhoods. Since neighborhoods should not just be any set, we also assume that the space satisfies some properties. Before we get there, let's describe what it means for a function between topological spaces to be continuous at a point. Like in the real case, we have that f is continuous at x if for any neighborhood of f of x, the pre-image is a neighborhood of x. Now back to the definition of a topological space. The first property we require is that the entire space is a neighborhood of every point. In the real numbers, a neighborhood of x was defined as any set containing an open interval around x. A key property of open intervals is that no matter where we pick a point inside them, there's always a smaller interval around that point that's still contained in the set. Sets with this property are called open, as they are a neighborhood of every point in the set. In general topological spaces, we want a set to be a neighborhood of X if and only if it contains an open set around X. Finally, the intersection of two neighborhoods of X should also be a neighborhood of X. These properties are, for example, satisfied by the neighborhoods we defined in the real numbers. These three properties complete the definition of a topological space by neighborhoods. Let's go back to our map between topological spaces. In practice, we are mostly interested in functions that are continuous everywhere on their whole domain, not just at individual points. If f is continuous everywhere and u is open, so a neighborhood of every point in u, we can move x around and get that the pre-image of u is also a neighborhood of every x, so it's open. So we get that the pre-image of any open set is open, if and only if the function is continuous. For everywhere continuous functions, we only need to know about open sets. So we can alternatively define a topological space by specifying its open sets directly. That is, a topological space is a set X together with a collection of subsets called open sets. We assume that the empty set and the entire space are open. Now take any set U, where for every point we can find an open set which contains the point and is contained in U. Then by our previous definition, U would be a neighborhood of every point in U, so U should be open. U is the union of all the open sets Ux. So it makes sense to require that arbitrary unions of open sets are open. The last property is that the intersection of two open sets is open. You can check that the two definitions of a topological space are equivalent. Note that we don't require infinite intersections of open sets to be open. That's generally not true. For example, in the real numbers, the intersection of infinitely many shrinking open intervals can give a single point, which is not open. Let's look at some examples of topological spaces. The real numbers form a topological space, where the open sets are those which contain an open interval around each point. More generally, we can define a topology on any metric space, where we require that around each point in an open set fits an open epsilon ball. For any set, we have the trivial topology, which just consists of the open set and the whole space. Intuitively, the trivial topology means that all points are condensed to one point, and no two points can be distinguished. Another topology is the discrete topology, which consists of all subsets. So is the power set. The discrete topology may be interpreted as that all points are isolated from each other. Now we have a very general notion of a space on which we can define continuous maps. Do these continuous maps behave like those in real analysis? And can we generalize the intermediate value theorem and the extreme value theorem to topological spaces? It turns out we can, if our spaces have some extra properties. The intermediate value theorem states that a continuous function on an interval takes on every value between f of a and f of b. For topological spaces, this holds if the domain is a connected space. This is a consequence of the more general fact that the image of a connected space is again connected. The extreme value theorem states that a continuous function on a closed and bounded interval attains its maximum and minimum. This remains true if we replace a closed and bounded interval with any compact space. More generally, the image of a compact space under a continuous map is again compact.